master thesis defense by Simon Ho.
Yes.
Chen. Chen. Chan. Sorry. And the thesis title is Revealing the Mystery of the Universe with Macari and HSC. And first, Simon will have a talk for 40 minutes, but in total, but please if you have a question, please ask in the middle. And maybe in total 1 hour. Maybe, but yeah. Anyway,
after the talk is okay.
Mm. So, yeah, okay. So, let's start. Yeah, please.
Thank you. Good morning, panelists, professors, and everyone. Welcome to my master's defense. I'm Simon Ho, and my supervisor is Professor Tomotsu Goto. It is my great pleasure today to share with you what I've done in the past 2 years during the master program in IOA NTHU. So my thesis title is Revealing Mystery of the Universe with Akari and HSC. To start with, I would like to give you my outline. So this talk is basically composed of two parts. The first part will be for the magic regressions. It starts with an introduction and followed by the data sets, and then parameter analysis, and finally there will be discussions. And part two is about quasar poles. It also starts with an introduction, and then quasar sample, and sample selection results, and finally there will be some future works. So I want to clarify this. So part one is OLOC parties complete work and is submitted to MRIS recently. And the second one is an additional work that after I finished this work, so I did a quasar analysis. So let's start with the first part. The first part will be for the magic regressions in the non-ecliptic whole wide field based on a deep optical survey with a hypersupreme camp. So this work is resubmitted to MRIS recently, and hopefully it will be accepted soon. So I will start with introduction. So there will be a first question. Why? So you know that in our work is basically infrared data. So why is infrared data important in our works? The reason to answer this, we will say that we want to review the high-resolution universe. So we want to know the cosmic star formation history. We want to know how star formation works in the high-resolution, and we want to reveal the dark side of the universe. However, there's a problem, because most star formation is hidden by dust, like nearly 90% at redshift more than 1. So if you want to use optical, it's very difficult to reveal the star formation history. Therefore, we need infrared, because for infrared data, we can see through dust. Like, for example, here I show the image of Carina Nebula in optical. You can see the dust. There is something here. But after you use infrared data, you can see there are more sources behind this dusty interstellar medium. The next thing I want to introduce is Akari. So this is the major source of data, which is an infrared space telescope. So Akari is the infrared space telescope which launched in the year of 2006, February. And it had a 16-month cryogenic mission lifetime. And it has contributed like around 1 year on the non-ecliptic wide field, also known as NEPW field. This is around 75% of emission lifetime, so it contributed a lot of time on the field. Just let you know where exactly NEP field is. So this is here where we are, the Akari telescope, and this is right here, the NEP field. It's on the top of our ecliptic sphere. So we are using the infrared camera, IRC, in Akari. It is focusing on the near to infrared, mid infrared wavelength. So what's so special about this camera is it has a very unique continuous night band photology from infrared to mid infrared wavelength. So from this filter curve here, you can see there is no single gap in between the filters. compared with other infrared famous telescopes like Spitzer or WISE here, you can see there are some gaps in between the filter's response. So in principle, Arcari can detect those missed sources due to these gaps. So in 2012, Kim et al. He published a paper about Arcari data on the North Ecliptic Wide Field. And this is the data. This was the data coverage at that time. And to mention, this is the NED Wide Field, the whole region. And then the smaller gray circle here is the NED Deep Field. At that time, we only have three data. The first one would be CWG Mega Cam, and the second one is Magellanic SNU Cam. And these two are the optical data we had. And the third one is Arcari IRC, which is the infrared data, the most important one in our field. So at the time, we also have around 3,000 SPEXI data. It sounds a lot, right? But actually, it's nuts, because we have around 100,000 infrared sources, which is, if there is only 3,000 SPEXI sources, it's not enough for 100,000 sources to carry out further research, because we need less information to carry out further research. So, and also, it's worth mentioning that our deep optical data, a deeper one, CWG Mega Cam, only covers the deep NEP deep field, like this red rectangle here, but it doesn't cover the whole NEP wide field. Only the SNU can cover the whole NEP wide field, but the depth is too shallow. This is not good enough for our research or even correlating photometric regressions. You may be confused because I keep saying photo Z and photometric redshift and spatial photometric redshift. So I want to introduce this work to you before I come to the next topic. So what is photometric redshift? It's basically photo Z in abbreviation. And what is spectroscopic redshift? It's basically SPEXI. So photo Z is basically estimating redshift based on this photometric data alone. Compared with SPEXI, it's less accurate, but much faster and less expensive. So in opposite, SPEXI is finding redshift based on its features in spectra. It's very accurate because it's the way most of the astronomers are finding redshifts based on the emission features. But however, it is very time and money consuming. Like if you use SPEXI, you would take more than 10 times time and work to do it. So many current and future surveys only deliver photometric data. Also, spectrum of phase gaps is very hard to obtain. So therefore, photo-Z is a really efficient and powerful method to get redshift information. So we say that we don't have deep optical data for correlating photo-Z, and we don't have enough SPEXI. So our solution is we need photo-Z, but how to get deep optical data is the next problem. So we need deep optical data on the NEP wide field. Fortunately, in 2017, Goto et al. Wrote a proposal to Subaru HSC team and asked for observation time on the NEP wide field for HSC data. So here, we finally got HSC data, which are these four cyan circles here, and it covers the whole NEP wide field. And it's worth mentioning that HSC data is much deeper than MegaCam. For example, for G-band here, it's 2 magnitudes deeper than the MegaCam G-band. And also, I want to mention that in this color diagram here, you can see that there are some red sources here. So these red sources are actually the source can be detected before HSC data, before we have HSC data. So after we have HSC data, we have much more sources. We have black sources here. So this is the advantage of our HSC sources. So finally, we have more than 3,000 SPEXI and also this HSC data. So we can finally calculate photometric redshift for this region. Another question to me may be, you may ask me why photo-Z is important. So I want to show you a review article from Nature Astronomy. It's about photo-Z. So actually, these are some very famous photo-Z astronomers. And I want to point out out something in the abstract. So you can see that they mentioned that photos are necessary for many scientific research projects, like ranging from investigation of the formation and evolution of galaxies and AGNs, and even cosmology. So you can see that photos is very important because many research will need photos. To be more specific, it will be galaxy astronomy and cosmology. Just in case you don't know what I'm mentioning, I will show you a method for how photos is important. So here you can see a 2D map of Taiwan here. So from this map here, you can only know the shape of Taiwan or some relative position. You cannot know other information from Taiwan. But later, if you know this, if you see this map here, you can see there are different colors here. And these colors are the elevation information from Taiwan. So you can know that there are some mountains here and also some flatlands here in the west side of Taiwan. So basically, we calculate photos for the similar reasons, because we need to know more information of our universe. So redshift is basically making 2D into 3D. In the previous one, it's just 2D image, but we are making it into a 3D image like this. You can see some mountains here. And also I want to show you how it works in the universe. So I want to play this video here.
You need to bring the cursor into this big screen, I think. Or you can do that too.
Sorry, my computer is hanging.
Can I stop the presentation once?
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry about this.
Nine.
So here I want to show you a video about, so you can see back deeper here. But what you can know is only there are some dots here. But after you know the redshift for these sources, you can see that it's actually, they are with different redshift and with different distance. So this is how redshift making 2D into 3D images. So we come back to the talk. The next question is how we compute photos. We compute photos based on a very typical, very general method, which is called spectral energy distribution, also known as SED fitting. So SED is actually the distribution of energy over wavelength and frequency. So from this image here, you can see that for different bands, different wavelength, the source shows different features and of course different photometric data. So by using these different photometric points, we can fit it with the different type of models. So I want to show a GIF here. So here you can see that for different redshift, the spectra of a source is actually, for galaxy is actually different. So we can use different spectral shape to fit it with the data points to know the redshift. For example, this source here is around 0.197 in redshift. And the code we use for SED fitting is called LUFA. And the reason why we use LUFA is because it's one of the most popular codes for doing photo-C. And also, it's relatively easy. And also, LUFA has a very powerful function is auto-adapt. You can automatically correct the zero points for our future. So that's the reason we chose Grafana. And later I want to introduce the data sets in our talk. So we are using the data from NEP band merge catalog. This band merge catalog is actually matched by Songjin Kim, one of our collaborator, and he's writing the paper about this. And actually he paid a lot of great efforts on making this catalog. It's very difficult to make it. And we have around 92,000 sources in total, 2,000 of them with Spexy, and the Spexy are from different campaigns. Here I show the coverage of our data here. You can see the larger circle here is our NEP data. Now we have much more data, including the deep of the code HAC data. So before we do data analysis, we need to do star galaxy separation because stars are the sources we don't want for galaxy astronomy. So what we did was we used chi-square gal and chi-square star. For chi-square gal is the chi-square variable when the SED fitting is running when the source is fitted to galaxy templates. And for chi-square star is fitted to stellar templates. So if chi-square gal is larger than chi-square star, it will be a possible star candidate. In opposite, when chi-square gal is smaller than chi-square star, it will be a possible galaxy. And the reason we don't use size or stellarity is because we don't want to remove AGN. For AGN and stars, they have similar stellarity and size. They are all like point sources. So you don't want to mess them up. Instead, we use chi-square value. For stars, AGN, and galaxy, their spectra are very different. So using chi-square value will be more promising in separating the star and galaxy. So here I show you a color plot, which is HAC R band minus Akari N4 versus HAC R band minus HAC I band. So here you can see a very obvious stellar sequence here, which is the result of our star galaxy separation. And also this one here is the galaxy sequence. For the red one has a higher ratio one, and for the black one has a lower ratio one. And also I overplot the spectroscopically identified sources here. You can see that the blue one are spectroscopically identified galaxies. And for these green stars here are those spectroscopically confirmed stars. So they are consistent with each sources. So next I want to define some statistical symbols in our talk. So I want to mention that we assess the photo-C accuracy by only comparing with the spec-C. And next I want to introduce N-gal, which is the number of included galaxies with photo-C within certain ratios. Next one is eta, which is the outlier fraction. And outlier are defined as delta photo-C divided by 1 plus spec-C, which is larger than 0.15. And sigma is the photo-C dispersion. And this is actually the normalized median absolute deviation, which is defined by this formula here. So I will show you this plot here. This is eta. This is N-gal, which is the number of included galaxies. And this is eta, which is the photo-C dispersion. And this is sigma, which is the this is outlier fraction. And this is sigma, which is the photo-C dispersion, which shows how dispersed our data is. And the outlier fraction is divided by these two blue lines. So for those sources which are outside these two lines, are outliers. So you may ask me a question before I show you the analysis. So I told you that we assess the photo-C accuracy by comparing only with the spec-C. But I mentioned that spec-C, they are basically estimating ratio based on some brighter galaxies. So what if our data is biased to the bright galaxy? So actually we did weighting to match our spec-C data with our photometric sample by using this nearest neighbor code from Lima et al. And for nearest neighbor, it's actually kind of like machine learning code for doing regression and matching classification works. So in this case, we want to do magnitude distribution matching. So here I show you the SPECSE magnitude distribution here, and also the magnitude distribution of photometric data. But we don't want them to be different. We want them to be the same. So we need to use a weight to match them. Like for these sources, there are too many here. We want to make it less by using weights. So we tell the code that this was, we need to reduce the number of sources here, but increase the number of sources here. So that we use the weight, and the red one is our results. After weighting the SPECSE data, our SPECSE finally matches with the orange photometric sample. So now our data is not biased to the magnitude.
I still don't quite understand how the weights are computed.
So the weights, so we input HSE bands like GR, SUY band to the code, and you will, and also the photometric bands into the code, and you will use, to be honest, I don't know the detail, but you will match the magnitude distribution so that, and then they will calculate the weights for each of the SPECSE data, so that the magnitude distribution is matched.
So it will compute, like, it will fit in the filters and the exposure times for different.
I only input the magnitude for the bands, and you will match them.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, I don't know.
Yeah, it sounds like magic to me.
Yeah. It was also a surprise for me. But anyway, the result is quite good, and
so the green distribution becomes real. Actually, I didn't understand either in your cases.
So
green distribution becomes real.
So here I'm showing you the normalized counts.
Yeah.
So this histogram are normalized. Actually, the SPECSE sample is very small, only 2,000 sources. But this orange one is around 60,000. So by inputting SPECSE data and photometric data, those HSE bands, they can compute some weights for the all SPECSE data. By using that weight, and then you can plot this red curve here, which is matching with the orange distribution.
So maybe you can, you know, explain in a previous SPECSE versus PhotoSE.
Yes.
You're explaining with this yesterday,
right? Right. So for our SPECSE data, they are biased to this brighter region.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to add weights to this fainter one because they are more important in our photometric data. So in our weighted sample, this data is actually more important. So when we are calculating eta and sigma, they play the more important role inside.
Okay, so, can you go to that?
Yes.
But there is no, maybe next one. So, this one. So, there is no gray data at the highest mean, right? You see, 27 point something. But you, in the red one, you have data here. So there is no data in the original script here, right?
Yes.
But you have something here. What is it? Well, I have a good misunderstanding. Because you adjusted this distribution to become this one,
right?
But there is no original data here. You produce some data.
I think
maybe I misunderstood something.
Yes, I think there is nothing here, but I need to check about it.
So someone is doing it in 5 bands. So there should be a data in other bands. Otherwise, as you say, there will be no data. So it must be detected in other bands.
I did check,
but it must be
done.
Sorry, I forgot to mention. Yes, we are not only doing it in G band, but also other bands. So actually, the distribution from different bands are different.
Okay.
So that's the reason why there's data here.
Okay. So you just represent the G, your distribution with G band, but you have distribution for other bands.
Yes, we are actually matching. We input 5 bands phonology to this code. They are matching 5 bands.
Okay.
And because this code it doesn't take non-detection, so we only use HAC bands, which have the most detections in our catalog.
Okay, I think we can buy it.
Thank you. And then later we want to design which bands we need to use for calculating SCD, calculating for the C, for doing SCD fitting. So here I show you our data from article to name variant. You can see that our data are actually wide range. We cover nearly all the photometric wavelength here. And also, it's worth mentioning that we need to detect some feature in our spectra so that SCD fitting works. So, like, there is Balmer break in low redshift, and also there is Lyman break in high redshift. So we need near-infrared data to detect this Balmer break, and we also need narrowband or U-band data for detecting this Lyman break so that our process is good enough. And optical data is also important for this range. So in total, we collected 26 bands from Mitanak VLI to WISE-1-2, which is near-infrared data. So this is the first test we did, was we compared different tempered models. So this time here, I set 26 bands as the control variable from optical to near-infrared data. Here I show you 7 different setups with different tempered models. And for each model, it actually takes like 1 hour. And actually, I did more than 7 sets, but I will show you the most typical one. So here we can see that for Cosmos, it has the smallest weighted eta, which is outlier fraction 11.3%, and the smallest weighted sigma, which is 0.053 here. And it's also worth mentioning that for Cosmo AGM, it's actually this template model is actually I try added AGM templates to Cosmos, but actually it didn't work so well because for low redshift, some galaxy is confused with AGM. So that's the reason why this doesn't work so well. So at last, we use Cosmos as our best suitable template.
So for the AGN, is it just one single template, or there are several for different types of AGN?
Yes, we have tried adding. Actually, we use the AGN templates from Swire, and they have 6 different AGN templates. So we try to add all these 6 AGN templates into Cosmos to see how it works, but eventually it doesn't work so well.
But if you want to study AGN, you obviously need AGN template. So
yes.
This means that you are not interested in AGN, or mis identification of AGN is more serious than missing AGN or something like that. Are you saying?
So we actually think about this question, but AGN is a small population in our catalog,
yeah,
and galaxy is more important for other work. So by taking balance, we want to have accurate photosy for all the galaxy samples.
Yes. But if you use sample only AGN, your photosy may be very long.
Yes.
So maybe one remark could be that maybe your sample cannot be used to study AGN.
Yes,
well,
I think for the user, if they want to use AGN, they need to consider.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Actually, we also checked those AGN sources. The performance is not that bad, but worse than with AGN templates, of course. But taking balance again, so we finally decided to use Cosmos only.
Okay.
In terms of the dispersion, it doesn't look that bad.
Right.
It it's just that it misidentified many sources.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm.
And 6% is actually quite big, so we don't want 6% of galaxy to be misidentified.
And I wanted to ask later because it's quite fundamental. So misidentification was 13% looks, I'm not a specialist, but 10% is identified wrongly. So it's quite, to me it's very large.
Yes. So,
is it?
Yeah.
So what's your comment?
Actually, compared with other work like Cosmos, our data is, our results of outlier fraction is very bad compared with other data. But actually, this is not our advantage. So we are not saying that we have the smallest outlier fraction, because we have more important infrared data, which is the unique feature in our catalog. And also, actually, we compare this value with the previous work done in the NEP field, and actually our work is much better than the previous work. So we will say that this is our best performance in the NEP. Given the risk, given that we have a shallow data compared with other works.
But some studies need more precision, right? Maybe some, it depends on what kind of statistics you want to do.
Yes.
So maybe 10%, I don't know. So can you still do some,
for 10%, I guess 10% is enough for galaxy astronomy, but for research like wavelength
cosmology
maybe a little bit difficult. But that's what the best we can do now.
Okay.
So the next thing we did was we compared different filter combination, and this time we fixed Cosmos as the control variables. Here I show you 11 different setup with different filter combinations. You can see that they are with different outlier fraction and sigma. So here you can see that the setup one is actually the best case with the smallest sigma and theta. And this setup one is actually 26 bands from either like optical data to near infrared, which I mentioned in the previous slides. So this is actually the best filter combination in our case. And it's worth mentioning that for setup 3, we try to remove HSC bands to see what the result looks like. So you can see that actually the result is much worse when we remove HSC data. So this emphasizes the importance of our HSC deep optical data in our catalog. And also, it's also worth mentioning that setup 7 is the data while we are removing Akari data. So actually the performance is also worse compared with the one with everything. So it also emphasizes the importance of Akari data in our catalog in terms of OOC performance. So now we concluded, we claim that we have the best parameter, which is Cosmos as galaxy templates, and also Mitre-Knight to WISE 1-2 near infrared data, 26 band data, as our best filter combination. And just want to show you the filter curves of 26 bands here. And this is the photo Z versus spec C plot, which is lower than versus 1.5. You can see that our best result is around 1,924 galaxies. And the weighted eta is 11.3%, and the weighted sigma is 0.053. And I believe this is the one of the best results in our field based with the lack of deep narrowband data. And I also want to show you the redshift distribution in our catalog. So the blue one here is the spec C redshift distribution in our catalog. And the gray one here is our photo C distribution. And we have also fitted a Gaussian fitting here. So you can see that the redshift distribution is quite good with no strange feature within the redshift range. And we also compare our work with other work which was previously done in the NEP field. in Negrero et al. 2009, they did flow C for the MEPT field. So for the same redshift range from 0 to 1.5, they accomplished a redshift dispersion which is 0.1. Compared with our result, it's much worse. And also the outlier fraction is more than 2 times of our outlier fraction for 559 sources. And it's worth mentioning that at that time they only use Akari data, they don't have any optical data. This is probably the reason why their velocity is bad, and this is also our the reason why we need optical HSC data. This emphasizes the importance of HSC in our catalog. So this is the last slide in my talk, but you may ask me, Simon, what are you going to do with our velocity? Are you going to do any research of using this velocity? So I want to show you some research which are done by our collaborators. And actually, they are using my velocity. Like Wang et al. Submitted, she was doing AGN contribution version redshift in NEP. And Huang et al., he is finding cluster in NEP. Santos et al., he is doing AGN contribution to local density relation in NEP. And actually, all this work, they need redshift. So you can see that if I don't give them redshift, they cannot do any research. And to be more specific, they may not be able to graduate in the future. But if you pay attention to it last week, there was an event, which is actually Wang et al. This person here, she actually successfully defended for her master thesis last week. So you can see that my philosophy is actually working, so she can be mastered. So the part two of my talk is...
But still, so main topic is AGN, so I need to do part two. But as I said, so redshift identification itself is not so bad. Maybe because the SED is dominated by stars or physically.
Right.
Maybe.
And also actually in their work, we have spec C and velocity data. So if the data they have spec C and velocity all together, they will try to use spec C data as first
project.
Yeah, first priority. So actually the redshift is
yeah.
still accurate for those sources. But for Flow C, we are not sure about it.
So when you say for AGM, it's worse, but it's only 0.02%, right? So it's not either, it's just a little bit 0.02% worse quality by choosing a cosmos temperate. So if you say, oh, this is not good for AGM, I think it's a little too much.
Yeah.
And then also, these AGNs are mostly type 1 AGN, so type 2 AGN is no problem.
Okay.
Because optical SED is dominated by host.
In that case, it's.
And then these type 2 AGN are our main focus because we are doing infrared AGN.
So I will come to the next part, which is unveiling quasar host galaxy and its lambda alpha emission at pressure 6 by Schecks. So I will start with introduction. So what is quasar? Quasar is actually also known as QSO, it's an extremely luminous active galactic nucleus. And most astronomers believe that every quasar is powered by a supermassive black hole. And also there are astronomers concluded that for most, if not all, galaxy hosts massive black holes at the centers. So actually, quasar is a very and quasar is also quite related to its host galaxy. And astronomers want to know the relations between quasar and its host galaxy because they want to know if quasar is really that luminous, if it's really distant like what we know, and also is what's so powerful is powering this quasar so that it is so luminous. They want to check if host galaxy is doing the work. So here I show you the quasar image. Hubble Space Telescope. So from the left panel, you can see a very luminous quasar here. and this, this is the light from it. And after we block the lights from the quasar by a chromograph, you can see that there is something around the quasar. And this is actually the quasar host galaxy of this quasar. So this quasar, which is VC273, is a redshift 0.158 quasar. So there are, I mentioned that there are astronomers doing research about the relationship with of quasar with its host galaxies. So like Maldino et al. And Cid Fernandez et al., they found that there are luminous AGNs showing evidence of starburst features. And also for Genzo et al. And Goto et al., they found that half of the ultra-luminous infrared galaxy ULEP, they contain simultaneously and AGN and starburst activity. So basically, in normal case, only galaxy shows starburst features and starburst activity. So we can know that quasar is actually closely related to host galaxy. Here I want to show you some quasar host galaxy with different redshifts. So here I show you some low C quasar host galaxies with Hubble space images, and the redshift is as low as 0.082 here and 0.135. Here is the quasar itself, and this extended part is the host galaxy of this quasar. And also here you can see the host galaxy. And actually there are more research about quasar hosts with different redshifts, like this paper that show the quasar host of C equals to 2. And this is an optical research about it. And here they also study the quasar host galaxy at redshifts 4.8. And this is the ALMA observation about it. And this is the CO emission of quasar 6 at redshift 6. So far you can see that there are many different studies about quasar host galaxies with different redshifts. But they are mostly radio data and at low redshift. For the high redshift one, most of them are radio data. So actually, we didn't find many research, but only one research. He was doing studies of quasar host galaxy at redshift C larger than 6 by optical data. So from Goto et al., he was doing quasar host galaxy and his Lyman alpha emission at redshift 6.43 by using one very luminous quasar. So at that time, he detected the quasar host galaxy and its Lyman alpha emission. So actually, our work in part 2 is taking this paper as a reference. Instead of using only one quasar, we use more than 50 quasar by stacking so that we can have a higher signal to noise ratio. So you may ask me, why did I need to stack it? So here I show you the emission of different sources in our galaxy at redshift 6. You can see that for the red one, it's actually the emission of from the 6.42 redshift quasar from SDSS. But this blue one, a very small peak here, is actually the galaxy at redshift 6. For emission, you can see that galaxy at redshift 6 is very small compared with the quasar itself. So actually, it's very hard to detect by optical when you want to detect the quasar host galaxy. Therefore, we need to stack it. So stacking is basically the method we use to increase the signal-to-noise ratio. And we take the median of the image so that we have a better signal-to-noise ratio image. So let's assume that we have 50 images from the quasar samples. So for 50 images, the increase of their other stacking is about 2.12 based on this rough calculation. So this is the increase of signal-to-noise ratio factor. I would also like to show you the C-band depth in HAC is about 25.9. So by increasing 2.12 magnitude, we have a new limited magnitude, which is 28.02. And I would also like to show you the typical galaxy around quasar field in C band at redshift 6. is around 26.5. So after we do the stacking work, we can see that our limiting energy becomes much deeper, so that it's more likely to detect a host galaxy at redshift 6. Later, we need to do sample selection of our quasar sample. So I would like to show my quasar sample first. My quasar sample is mainly composed of three different data from three different surveys. So the first one is SHAX, which is the Subaru High Sea Exploration of Low Luminosity Quasars. And the second one is SDSS, and the third one is CLGQS. And actually, my sample is mainly composed of the data from SHAX, which is from around 100 quasars. There are 91% of the data from SHAX. And the redshift range is around 5.7 to 7. And actually, this SHAX survey is the first time for us to detect so many high redshift quasars at the same time. In the past, Astronomers was only doing one quasar or maybe less than 10 quasars at a time. But this time, they have detected more than 100 quasars at the same time. So we are using this survey data, and also we try to reobserve it with HSE data, all three survey data all together, by using the RIDEC from the spectroscopic poly identified catalog. So we get the C band and Y band data from HSE SSPDR2. And just to mention, HSE SSPDR2 survey is a Subaru HSE survey on the whole universe, not the whole universe, but they focus on this wide field, which are the data in the dark red region. So actually, we are finding quasars. Just they are finding quasars within this field. And if you want to know where is NEP, NEP is here. So we cannot use NEP data for doing this. So next, I would like to answer why we are using C-band or NY-band only. So here I show you a spectrum of a quasar at redshift 6. And later I overplot the HSE filters here. You can see that for C-band and Y-band, they are the only bands that covering the emission part of this spectrum. So that's the reason why we are using C-band and Y-band. And later we need to do sample selection. So we want to remove quasars with nearby sources within 20 pixels so that there is no contamination while we are stacking. And we also want to remove sources with best seeing size that is over a three sigma distribution. I will talk about this later. And also we need to apply a redshift cut to remove non-detection in some bands, like C equals to 6.8 for Z band. So you may ask me why 6.8 in C band. So here I show you different spectra of quasar at different redshifts. You can see that for when I plot HSC filter edge here, the detection limit of our HSC band is like around 6.87. Higher than 6.87, you cannot detect any emission by using HSC band. So that's the reason we remove sources which is higher than 6.8. And also, there are different seeing size of our images due to different weather condition or different CCD in HSC. Like you can see that this pixel here is larger than this pixel here. So we don't want this effect to affect our results while we are stacking. So we want to unify the seeing size in our images. So I plotted the seeing size distribution histogram in C-band here, and I also make a 3 sigma cut here. Normally, we do unification based on the largest seeing size in the sample, but we don't want to be so extreme like seeing size which is 5 pixel or 5.4 pixel. Therefore, we remove these sources in our sample. Instead, we use seeing size which is 4.4 in our sample. So now, after Gaussian convolution, all our samples are in seeing size 4.4. We remove them. And after applying the above selection criteria, we are left with a sample of 46 clean quasars, which is regression median 6.13. And so we wanted to remove the quasar parts in the center of our image so that we can see the whole galaxy around it. So we need to make something which is similar to quasar. Actually, we are making a PSF. So PSF, it describes the response of an imaging system to a point source like quasar or stars. So we are using stars to compute our PSF. So we use S-extractor to identify all the sources in our image. And then we choose 46 nearby stars with severity larger than 0.97 within the image size, which is 60 arcseconds. Also, we try to normalize the star images to flux one so that they have a similar magnitude. And then we stack the stars with median as combined operation. So therefore, we can have a PSF. And how did we remove the PSF from the quasar image? We use ScaleFit, which is a data analysis algorithm that fits 2D image to point source of galaxy. Like an example here, there are some galaxy and point source here, and then you fitted it with components, a model, so that after subtraction, you can see there is nothing here in the residue. So this is a schematic plot of what I'm doing in the last slide. So at first, we need to use an image, which is 60 arcseconds times 60 arcseconds large. And actually, we have 66, or we have 46 image of this kind of image. And there is a quasar in the center and a star, which is nearby. And later, we need to do Gaussian convolution to unify the seeing size. So we have 46 convolved images with the same 4.4 pixel seeing size. And then we need to make PSF. For PSF, we need to do normalization so that the magnitude is similar. And then we stack the PSF altogether, so we have a stacked PSF with 46 images. And we also want to stack the quasar, so that we use iRuff again, and we stack quasar. So now we have a stacked quasar with 46 images. And later, we use this PSF here, and subtracted this quasar, stacked quasar here, with GalFit. And then we can have a residue, which can probably be the quasar host galaxy. So I would like to show you the first PSF subtraction results. Here is the PSF subtraction. So the left panel I'm showing you a stacked quasar, which is combined by 46 quasar altogether. And the middle one is PSF plus sky components, which is also computed by 46 PSF altogether. And the right one is this subtract from this. Is this one minus this, so it is the residue. So if you have good eyes, you may see there is something extended around the center.
Why is the central region oversubtracted?
So this oversubtracted is because we only fit PSF to this at this case. So this oversubtracted region is probably due to the quasar host galaxy because we didn't subtract the quasar and PSO together. So it's kind of, GalFit didn't fit it so well because we didn't consider the host galaxy, but only the PSO. So. But for the middle one, it's difficult because we need to do some pixel subtraction to remove this. But we have already did our best, because GalFit doesn't work for subpixel level. So the middle part is neglectable. So you may not believe this image here. So I wanted to show you the radio profile of our results. So here I plot the radio profile of our PSF plus sky and also the quasar plus host here. So the blue one is actually this one, the PSF, the quasar plus host, and the red one is the PSF plus sky. You can see there is an excess of quasar plus host here. So I would like to show you the residue again. And I did a little bit smoothing here. So you can see there is something around the quasar actually. And we claim that this part is actually this part, which is accessed in the quasar and host galaxy. And this extended structure is, it is with a half light radius, which is 8.75 pixels, which is correspond to 1.49 arcsecond and around 9.3 kiloparsecond large. And next we did also PSA plus Celsic subtraction test here. And just to give you some knowledge, that Celsic profile is actually a mathematical function that describes how the intensity and the galaxy varies from distance out from its centers. So for different galaxies, you can fit a different Celsic radio profile with different Celsic index. So like for example, this one, M87 is an elliptical galaxy with Celsic index n equals to 4. So n equals to 4 is probably an elliptical galaxy in this case. So we try to remove also the galaxy parts from our quasar host image. So here is the results. So PSF is a quasar and Celsic is a galaxy component we want to remove from the image. The left panel is against the stack quasar. And the middle panel is PSF plus sky plus Celsic components. And the right panel here is the residue. You can see this time there is no more extended structure here. So
could you go back a little bit? Yeah, and why is this model not spherical symmetric?
Because for Celsic, this is actually a 0.02 Celsic profile, and the shape is like that after you combine it with a PSA, because it's more like a disk galaxy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So it's not only dependent on radius?
Yeah, you're not only dependent on radius. And I will explain more about this in the later slide.
Mm-hmm.
This is actually not only host galaxy, because actually something else. So Galfi, they fit at this shape.
Mm-hmm.
But it's obvious, so it means that it's not spherical.
Yes,
I mean,
in this case.
Yes. Anyway, yeah, we can go.
So I also plot the radial profile here, which is PSF plus Celsic subtraction. You can see that this time there is no more excess of the quasar plus host, because it is finally subtracted by PSF plus Celsic plus sky here. So you may ask me, what could this extended structure be? As I mentioned, it could be quasar host galaxy, but actually it is more like the combination of quasar host galaxy and Lyman alpha blob. So what is Lyman alpha blob? You can see that from this spectrum here. This is the spectrum of redshift 6 galaxy. At this HSC C band range, you can see that the largest emission is actually the Lyman alpha emission. So there are some research about high redshift emission, Lyman alpha emission previously. So people found that there is actually a large structure of Lyman alpha block in a high redshift universe. And this Lyman alpha block is very unique. So if this is not galaxy host, of the quasar, it could be still very interesting to study about this in our quasar sample. So in order to know how many percentage is Lyman alpha blob and how many percentage is quasar host galaxy, we want to do some future works. Like when you want to do PSF subtraction in wide band so that there is no more Lyman alpha emission in the image. And also we need to do SED fitting to the extended structure so that we can calculate the standard mass and do modeling to see which percentage is quasar host and which percentage is Lyman alpha emission. So to summarize, for the first one, the complete work I've done was photometric redshift. We used 26 optical near infrared bands to compute photo-C for the NDPW field with SED canton based method, LUFA. And the weighted photo-C dispersion is 0.05 with less than 1.5 redshifts. And the weighted online fraction is 11.3% for less than 1.5 restaurants for around 2,000 sources. And for the second part, which is additional work I've done in the master program, was for example subtraction. So we stack HAC images of relationship around 6 from the sharks data, and we have carefully subtracted a stack PSF from the stack quasars. So we have detected a standard structure with half-life radius of around 2.55 parsec, which is 9.3 kiloparsec in the C-band. So this concludes our talk. Thank you.
So any question? Everything was clear. Yeah, any question is okay.
Although I may not be able to answer. Any question is okay.
How many galaxy quasars I don't know you just stuck?
I stacked 46 quasars after removing those bands.
Okay. I was still wondering about non-symmetric, non-spherical structure of the residue, but if it's 46, maybe if the original shape is very symmetric.
Yes. And we also think about this may be the combination of galaxy host and also Lyman overflow.
Mm.
So it may not be like a spherical symmetrical shape. Mm.
Then,
this is the model in Galton, right?
Yes.
Mm. Then my question may be, what is the meaning of fitting the residual with Celsic component? Because it's not simply a galaxy, right?
So, this is the preliminary test to see if this is only a crystal host. So our conclusion is that it may not be only crystal host, but some other thing else is combined altogether.
As a result, it fits quite well.
Yeah, it fits well. So
I think the Celsic index is a little bit low for galaxies.
Okay.
Maybe because of the reason you mentioned.
Can I ask? Yes. About the stacking. So I wonder if you tried having derived the PSF from the stars, did you then try subtracting that PSF from other stars in the image? Because I think that would be a very nice test.
Yes, so actually, we have tried subtracting a PSF with a stack, stack PSF with another star. But actually, we are still working on it. But we have tried one star minus one star in the past, and it works very well. I can show you the one star. So here I show you a star from one image and another star from the same image, and after Galfit subtraction, there's nothing here in the residue. And I would like to show you another example. This is also one star from another image and one star from another image. And this is also the residue, which is nothing
here. But here what you did was you just scaled one image to the same magnitude as the other image and then subtracted. The image, it's not, you didn't fit the PSF first and then subtract the PSF from the second image. Just subtracted the images directly.
Yes.
But what you're doing in the stacking for the get the quasar part, there you're fitting the PSF.
Yes, we are fitting to a PSF. So the PSF is combined the stack with 46 of this kind of thing. But actually we did PSF subtraction with 46 PSF 1 and 46 PSF 2. But the subtraction, there is some over-subtraction in certain parts. So we think about it, it may due to the sub-pixel performance in our Galfits. So we are still trying to make it better, but we didn't show it in this talk. But that's also the future work we are going to do.
Any other questions?
crazy.
So when you are studying these quasars, do you assume that all of them are similar in nature? So you're stacking them, so you combine all these quasars into one image.
Right.
So the procedure we get is actually a combination of all the,
right.
the environment for these quasars.
So what we did was, what we can assume is this quasar from the similar redshift. So we are actually only finding the typical galaxy, typical host galaxy from this stacked image. If it's typical, after stacking, you can show even we detect the median of the image. So that's the reason we are doing this. But if you ask me if they are different shape, I would say yes, but we are only showing the typical shape at redshift 6.
So your interpretation then is that every redshift 6 quasar has a big line alpha blob around
it. Yes, that's the most likely reason.
Any other question?
Yeah, we can. Yeah, stop. Yeah, so this Simon.